Hare Krishna. So today morning we are discussing from the Srimad Bhagavatam the concept of devotion in the three modes. Yesterday I talked about devotion in the mode of ignorance. Then we focus on making sure that we try to prove that I am right. So dambha, himsa, I especially talked about how just because our destination is right does not mean that our driving automatically becomes right. If my vehicle is jerky, noisy, polluting, it's how it will be even if I'm going to the right destination. So similarly, even if our ideological value becomes that Krishna is my goal, but that doesn't mean my functional value will naturally become transformed. It should, but it may take time. And unfortunately, sometimes our devotion, if misunderstood or misapplied, instead of aiding in the transformation, can actually aggravate staying in ignorance. We may rationalize our ignorant aggressiveness as transcendental concern for the Lord, and then we may criticize others, and that can lead actions in ignorance hurt us and hurt others, and that's what can happen even with religion. So we need to work to raise our consciousness from passion, from ignorance to passion through goodness and ultimately to transcendence. So now here we talk about devotion in the mode of passion. So vishayan abhisandhaya yasha aishwaryam evava. When religious activity is done with the desire for worldly gain, that is considered to be devotion in the mode of passion. So in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna talks about how yatu dharma kamarthan dhrityadharayate arjuna prasangena phalakangshi dhritisapartha rajasi. He talks about determination in the mode of passion. Is that though normally we think of passion as being materialistic, as being selfish, as being sensual. Now, in the Vedic context, passion is used in two senses. Sometimes the mode of passion is equated with the demonic nature. But sometimes there can be also what you could say pious passion. Somebody may be materialistic, but they may be pious materialists. So if you see broadly in terms of functioning, the devatas and demons both are interested in sense gratification. Both are interested in material enjoyment, material power, material position, material possessions. But the difference is that the devatas are ready to harmonize with the Lord, whereas the asuras, the demons, want to defy the Lord. So we could say, especially devata like Indra, who are very materially enamored, they would fall somewhere in the mode of passion. But if you consider, say, this is goodness, this is passion, this is ignorance. So the modes themselves are not necessarily monochrome. We may use one color to represent each mode. But within that color also, there can be shades. So there can be passion which is closer to goodness, and there can be passion which is closer to ignorance. So normally when we talk about the modes of passion and ignorance in the world today, it is often passion which is very close to ignorance. In scripture, passion is often talked about in terms of materialism which is sought to be promoted through religion. That is also considered in the mode of passion. So vishayan abhisandhaya, being attached to the worldly objects. And Krishna also says in the Bhagavad Gita 18.34 that yayatu dharma kama arthan, for one does dharma for artha and kama, dhritya dharayate arjuna. One is determined, so one does religious rituals also very firmly, but the idea is one wants to do it for gaining worldly pleasures, worldly powers. So this in the Vedic tradition is called as karma kanda. And one contemporary version of Karmakanda in today's world is in Christianity, which is called as prosperity theology or prosperity gospel. What does this refer to? Prosperity gospel means that if you become devoted to God, God will make you prosperous in this world. And that it's not just A leads to B, that if you do A, B will come. But it's also, if B is there, A must be there. That means your prosperity is the proof of your piety. And conversely, if somebody is in poverty, that poverty is the proof of their impiety. So this idea of prosperity gospel is prominently present in evangelical Christianity. Christians have two broad branches, Catholics and Protestants. So now Catholics don't advocate the prosperity gospel so much, but Protestants, many of them do. And this understanding or this notion that prosperity equates piety. So it's not just if A leads to B, that is fine. You know, if I go out of my house and see that the pavement is wet, then I can say it must have rained overnight. So I see B and I assume that A, that rain had happened. But this is a logic called the logical fallacy of assuming the antecedent. There is something which antecedent means what came before. So assuming that. Now the pavement might have been wet because rains had come. So if A, then B. If rains occur, then the pavement will be wet. But it doesn't mean if B, then A. Because the pavement might get wet because, say, somebody was watering the garden, and water came on the garden. Or some pipe overflew, and that's why the wetness is there. So basically, unless we can prove that B is caused only by A, logically, just because B is present, that doesn't mean A has to be present. And unless we can say that, so A should lead to B. So now A can lead to C and D and E also. So does A always lead to B? So this is a logical fallacy. What I'm trying to explain over here is that this equation, piety will lead to prosperity, and prosperity is the proof of piety. This is logically flawed, especially in transcendental devotion. Sometimes piety, or we could say more precisely, bhakti or spirituality, can lead not to prosperity but to poverty. Because Krishna may take things away from a devotee. Why? Because Krishna wants that devotee to be attached only to him and not to the things of this world. But this dynamic is not understood in the mode of passion. One is very caught in externals. Krishna talks about knowledge in the mode of passion in 18.21 in the Bhagavad Gita. And there he states that prithaktvena tu jnanam nana bhavan prithak vidhan vetti sarveshu bhuteshu tajjnanam vidhirajasam. In the mode of passion, we equate the essence of things with their externals. We equate people with their external bodies. So we equate the external results of religious performance with the essence of the religious performance. So in fact, this idea that prosperity is the proof of piety and poverty is the proof of impiety, that was one of the major factors that responsible for the evangelical zeal of European Christianity, which colonized the whole world. The Protestants, most of them went eastwards and they came to India, and large parts of the world they colonized. Of course, Protestants also came to America, and the Catholics, in order to not be outdone, they also started evangelizing, and they mostly evangelized South America. But America grew primarily on the Protestant ethos. And Protestant ethos was that you work hard in this world and then God will reward you with prosperity in this world. So the transcendent aspect of religion was significantly undermined in Protestant ideology, and not just in ideology, of course in practice. Now even the Catholic Church had become materialistic and corrupted, and not much transcendence was always there, but at least ideologically they accepted that we have to go beyond the joys of this world in order to experience the joy of the Lord. So here in the mode of passion, one is very attached to worldly objects. Vishayana abhisandhaya yasha aishwaryam evava. That aishwarya is prosperity. So the opulence of prosperity. So this very precisely we could say equates with the idea of the prosperity gospel. That these people think that the external material results prove our piety. This can lead to a very materialistic vision of religion, whereby one thinks that religion is simply a tool for a better life in this world. And Srila Prabhupada writes in a first canto purport that in the Vedic system of purusharthas, of the various goals of human life, there were four broad goals. Does anyone know what are those four goals? Dharma, artha, kama, and moksha. So dharma is piety, artha is prosperity, kama is, you could say, sensuality or worldly pleasure, and then moksha is the ultimate liberation. So by going through dharma, artha, kama repeatedly, gradually one would develop detachment, and then one would aspire for moksha. However, the problem comes, Prabhupada writes that if a society becomes materially prosperous, if people can get artha and kama without dharma, then they feel, what is the need for dharma? So we could say there is utilitarian religion and there is transcendental religion. Utilitarian religion means religion meant for utilitarian purposes. Utilitarianism was the idea propagated by a British thinker. He said that we should decide what is good and what is bad simply based on utilitarian values, how useful it is to us in this world. So many times religion is also positioned like that, utilitarianly. That means that what does your religion do for us practically here? And when religion is seen only as a utilitarian tool, not as a transcendental process, then whatever utilitarian gains are to be got, say from dharma, artha and kama will come. But if people can get artha and kama without dharma, then they feel, what is the need for dharma? So as is happening in the Western world, people have relative levels of material comfort and prosperity. So they feel, what is the need for God? So when dharma is positioned as a utilitarian tool to artha and kama, then after some time it becomes redundant. It becomes unnecessary. God and religion become dispensable. And to some extent, this is what science and technology have promised, and at least to some people, they feel it has delivered. One, if you consider there have been three broad ages, phases in recent history, the pre-modern age, the modern age and the post-modern age. So the defining difference between the modern age and the pre-modern age is that in the pre-modern age there was an understanding that there is another world which is life's ultimate goal, and this world is a preparation for attaining that world. Whether it was in Christianity or whether it was in various other Native American or other religions, or whether it was of course in India with the Vedic path. But the defining break between modernity and pre-modernity is in modernity the other world is considered unimportant or even non-existent or basically irrelevant. So how can we bring paradise in this world? So to some extent, technological progress came with the promise that technology will bring paradise in this world. In fact, some Christians even positioned science and technology that way. They said religion provides God's grace in the spiritual realm, and science provides God's grace in the material realm. So they felt that we will grow spiritually by religion, which is given by God through scripture, and we will grow materially by science, which is given to us by God. So at least they saw that scientific insights and scientific progress also coming from God. And they thought it will help us create a paradise in this world. But eventually, as the promise or the lure of a paradise in this world started becoming more and more seductive, then people felt, why do we need any other world at all? So in the modern times, the whole purpose of life is, or purpose of everything is, make life as happy as possible in this world. In modern times, marriages have become hugely fragile. They just break apart. Even at small provocation sometimes. Now, there are many factors that cause marital instability and breakups. But one major cause is that in the pre-modern times, marriage was seen as a duty, as an obligation. If pleasure comes from it, that is fine. But it is a duty, whether in India or in the West. Because marriage was something which was arranged by parents, by society, and it was a duty that was done. Whereas in the, and it was understood that by living dutifully, one will grow spiritually. But in today's world, marriage is seen as a choice for pleasure. The idea of a duty or obligation is hardly there. And because of that, if things become a little difficult, things don't seem to be working out, then we came together for pleasure. If you're not getting pleasure, what is the point of staying together? People break apart. So again, the idea that there is some higher purpose to life, that there is a higher world to be attained, that is lost. So how does all this historical analysis apply to us as sadhakas in the Krishna consciousness movement? We also may equate, we may not equate literally material prosperity or getting sense enjoyment with one's piety or one's spirituality or one's bhakti. But we may also, in the mode of passion, equate the material results of our service with the essence of devotion. That means that if somebody is able to distribute a lot of books, that means they must be a great devotee. If somebody's classes draw lots of people, that means they must be great preachers. If somebody has lots of followers, that means they must be great devotees. Now, at one level, Sri Prabhupada did indicate that we can know a Vaishnava by how many other Vaishnavas a person makes. But at the same time, Srila Prabhupada also quoted the Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, where it is said that one should not try to read too many books, build too many temples, or make too many disciples. So we cannot just take one aspect. Oh, this Vaishnava has made so many Vaishnavas, therefore this must be a great Vaishnava. Now, we don't want to become judgmental about others. Yesterday also I said that, you know, we don't want to categorize to put others into boxes. Our purpose is to understand the boxes that we are in so that we can come out of them. So, in our case also, we can apply this. Is it that the material results of a service prove that that service is pure and that we are advanced? Or the lack of the results at this level of, at this material level, prove that we are impure and that that Krishna is not pleased with our service? Not necessarily. If this were the case, if we consider that the material results alone prove the caliber of devotion, then is it that for 40 years when Srila Prabhupada was trying to share Krishna Bhakti in India, he got no results? So does that mean that for 40 years Prabhupada's devotion was not that great, and then in the last 11 years suddenly he became a great devotee and then the results came out? No, not like that. Prabhupada was always an exalted devotee. But the results came at a particular point by Krishna's plan. So we cannot simplistically equate the presence of results or the absence of results with the presence of devotion or the absence of devotion. There can be many factors involved. In our bhakti, if we start equating material result or external results with the essence of bhakti, then we can become very judgmental and even offensive. So sometimes for getting results in this world, some material abilities are required. So for example, if somebody is doing kirtans, and if they sing very sweetly and they just have the musical ability to sing very sweetly, their throat, their musical instinct is very good, then naturally for their kirtans many people will come. Now, does many people coming for their kirtan mean necessarily that they are great devotees? It may or it may not. Sometimes some speakers, they may be very humorous. And when some speakers are humorous, hundreds of people may come for their talks, even devotee speakers. Does that mean that they are advanced devotees? Could be, may not be. We cannot rate spiritual wisdom by the laughter test. We cannot rate spiritual wisdom by the laughter test. That, oh, you know, this person made me laugh so much. This person created, so many people came. Now, people are coming. There is, we could say, when a person is giving a class, if they're speaking about Krishna, there'll always be some illumination. That will always take us some steps towards enlightenment just by hearing about Krishna. Now, it is also the speaker's responsibility to try to present the message in as enlivening, as interesting a way as possible. So, even the hearing of the bhakti message can have some element of entertainment in it. But that is not the primary purpose. So we could have, because people are coming and hearing, people are distressed. So there can be some entertainment within it. But the primary purpose in speaking about Krishna is not entertainment, it is enlightenment. Now some speakers, by their past karma, by their present training, they may just be more lively and humorous than others. But that doesn't necessarily mean that they are more spiritually advanced. They may be, they may not be. And the capacity for humor is simply a result of past karma. And there was a famous Academy Award winning Nobel laureate comedian who committed suicide a few years ago. So I wrote an article about that for Back to Godhead on my website. I titled the article as After the Laughter. After the laughter. On the screen, on the dais, they are laughing and making others laugh. Now many celebrities have committed suicide, but when a comedian commits suicide, it is especially disorienting for people. Because we think a comedian makes everyone laugh, they make us happy, so they must also be happy. But no. No, the capacity to crack jokes is simply a material skill. Just like somebody can sing very nicely, somebody can manage very nicely, somebody can analyze very nicely, but that doesn't equate with happiness. Similarly, humor is a skill that some people have by past karma, but that doesn't mean that themselves are happy. So, laughing can also be simply a biological phenomenon. It need not even be psychological or spiritual. What do you mean by biological phenomena or biological event? Say, sometimes if we go to meet some friends or relatives and they have a small child in their home, and just to have some fun with the child, we may tickle the belly of that child. Now if you tickle the belly, the child may start laughing. Now if the child is laughing, is that laughter on tickling happiness?
No.
No. If that laughter were happiness, and all of us want to be happy, then all of us could get our own perpetual tickling machines. And whenever we want to be happy, we would tickle ourselves and we'll be happy. You know? So, in this case, laughter is simply a biological event. There's a biological stimulus, tickling, and a biological response, laughing. But that doesn't mean there's internal happiness. So similarly, we could say humor is like intellectual tickling. Some people, their bodies are more ticklish than others. Some people, you touch them and they start laughing. And some people, you just, nothing happens to them. So different people have different tickling capacities, you could say, or tickling sensitivities. So similarly, there's intellectual tickling. Some people may be very good intellectual ticklers, and some people love to be intellectually tickled. But that doesn't necessarily mean happiness. So the point which I'm making here is that in our bhakti, also, we may equate external results with the essence of devotion. And that can become very short-sighted, very judgmental, and very destructive also. So if I think so many people come for my programs, therefore I'm a great devotee. And this person, who comes for their program? Therefore, they're not great, they're all just ordinary people. But then, actually, they may just, by Krishna's plan, by past karma, they may just not have the material ability to speak effectively. But that doesn't mean that they don't have spiritual devotion. They may be much more advanced than what I am. And I need to be respectful. So, this can also, some people, if they have good managerial abilities, they may rise to positions of power in the moment. But that does not necessarily mean that they are more spiritually advanced than those who don't have those managerial abilities. So of course, if somebody has some ability which they are using in Krishna's service, then we respect them for that. We don't have to judge or condemn others. You know, it's simply your material ability there. There is no devotion. We don't know who has devotion and who doesn't have. We can give others the benefit of doubt, and we can offer them deference and appropriate respect according to the situation and the etiquette. But we need to be carried away by externals. Otherwise, we will end up becoming judgmental. So for us, the result, Prabhupada was asked at one time that, what pleases you the most? And the book distributors felt Prabhupada would say that book distribution pleases me the most. And Prabhupada said that if you love Krishna, that will please me the most. So ultimately, the phala Prabhupada wanted, if we say phalena parichayate, the result is a tree is known by its fruits, by the result. Then we have to see what is the result that is being talked about. Is it just how many temples built or how many devotees made, how many books distributed? That is one aspect of the result. Another very important aspect is how much love for Krishna is one developing? And how do we know whether somebody is developing devotion for Krishna, whether we are ourselves developing devotion for Krishna? I'll conclude with this point. The test is that what is our response when the material results are not there? If I am speaking only because so many people come for my program, and if people don't come, then I become unenthusiastic, I become averse, I start shouting, yelling at people, why didn't you organize properly? If my attachment to the result becomes greater than my attachment to Krishna, that means the lack of the result consumes my consciousness so much that there is no space left for Krishna in my consciousness. Then that indicates that actually I am more motivated, I am excessively, dangerously attached to the results, to the material aspects of my service, and I'm getting distracted from bhakti. So then we have to check ourselves and learn to study the philosophy, introspect, and refocus ourselves on Krishna. And refocus ourselves that my purpose in coming here to Krishna's lotus feet, to Krishna's movement, is not to get fame, not to gain power, not to gain wealth. If these come and if I can use them in Krishna's service, I'll do that. I'll be grateful for them as having them as facilities for expanding my service to Krishna. But what I primarily need is my connection with Krishna. How much can I be absorbed in Krishna? So the test of our devotion is not just how many material facilities we get, how many material abilities we get for serving Krishna. The test of our devotion is also how many material facilities and abilities without which we can serve Krishna. So, you know, if the more we can get along without material things, the more it can be an indication that we are spiritually focused on Krishna. We are purely motivated, or at least are becoming purely motivated. So we needn't, of course, be negligent of material facilities or reject material facilities. But if they are coming, we use them in Krishna's service. But if they are not coming, we don't have to become disheartened or excessively agitated. We can see that as an opportunity for us to focus on Krishna and strive to please Krishna. And thus, even if our present devotion is in the mode of passion, if we keep serving Krishna, then, and we don't let the material result dominate our consciousness, it will be there because we have the mode of passion, we have attachment. If I go for book distribution, if people don't take books, that will affect me somewhat. But if I don't let that result alone determine my service, I stay fixed in serving Krishna, whether the results come or not, then I will get the ultimate result of increasing my devotion to Krishna and becoming purely absorbed in Him. So I'll summarize. I spoke today about devotion in the mode of passion, where we become attached to external results and we equate the presence of external material results with the presence of inner devotion. So I talked about Western Christianity, which prosperity theology held that piety will lead to prosperity and prosperity proves piety. Conversely, poverty proves impiety. So now this is the fallacy of assuming the antecedent, where because B is present, I assume A is there. So like the rains are, the pavement is wet, that could be because of rain, that could be because of other reasons also. So similarly, when we equate that our religion will lead to external results at the material level, then we are misperceiving the whole situation. See, only one fragment of reality. Sometimes piety or bhakti may not lead to prosperity, may actually lead to poverty, because Krishna may want to make us detached from worldly things and attached only to Him. And conversely, prosperity may take one away from piety. Because if one gets artha and kama by mundane means, then one may feel, what is the need for dharma? So the defining difference between pre-modern and modern times is that in pre-modern times, this life was seen as a preparation for another life in another world. Whereas in modern times, this world is seen to be everything. And science and technology were seen as God's grace for doing in the material realm what religion was doing in the spiritual realm. But when material results started coming, then this positioning religion as utilitarian, as a tool to getting worldly things, led to religion becoming irrelevant when those material things came without religion. Nartha and Kam come without dharma. What is the need for dharma? So when we practice bhakti, we have to understand that religion is for the transcendental purpose of developing love for Krishna. And yes, because we are serving here, some material results may come here also. Now, in mode of passion, we equate the external results with the internal essence. So somebody may distribute more books, and that could be, somebody may attract many people, that could be because of their purity, but that could also be because of their material ability. So we discuss humor may attract a lot of people who want entertainment, and while speaking there can be entertainment plus enlightenment, but if people are coming primarily for the entertainment, then some people may be better entertainers than others and they may attract more people. So that doesn't necessarily mean that they are more advanced devotees. That devotion is something separate from the material results. The phala, the fruit, the test of a devotee is not just how many devotees somebody attracts to Krishna at the lotus feet, but how much one is oneself attracted to Krishna. So if the results come, we at the material level, we see them as facilities for serving Krishna and gratefully use them. And if the results don't come, we see them as a, that as opportunity to focus on Krishna without becoming agitated about the lack of results. In this way, whether the external result comes or not, at least the internal result of progressing in devotion will always be there for us. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Yes.
Subhanu.
Okay. Sri Madhupra. Let's take one at a time. I'll answer first. So, among the four categories of people who come to Krishna, the distressed, the wealth seekers, the inquisitive and the knowledgeable. So, the distressed and the wealth seekers can be in the modes of nature, the modes of passion. But what about the inquisitive and the knowledge seekers? Yeah, we could say that the distressed and the inquisitive, they are distressed and the wealth seekers, they are largely in material consciousness. So the need for something material or the problem at the material level is God is getting them to Krishna. So it could say in the mode of passion. Artho, the example that is given is of Gajendra. Artharthi, the example that is given of Dhruva. But these are examples where it is not just they came to Krishna for these purposes, from there they rose to pure devotion. So now this may sometimes take bahunam janmanamante. This is 7.16. Krishna 3 verses later talks about 7.19, that after many lifetimes these people may come to the level of pure devotion, surrendering to me. So if they just caught with artha and with material results, then they are in material consciousness and it may, they will evolve, but it will take a long time. Krishna puts the jnani in a separate category. Tesham jnani nitya yukta ek bhakti rishishyate priyo hi jnani nautyartham aham sacha mama priyaha. In 7.17 he says that. So that means that he says jnanis, this is not just dry jnanis who are monists. He's talking about those who with knowledge understand that Krishna is the ultimate reality. And they come to ek bhakti rishishyate. They come for pure devotion to Krishna. Then they are definitely those who are already at a transcendental level and they will progress further. The inquisitive, they are, you could say, having a little more mode of goodness because they are knowledge seeker. They want to know about it. But it is more of a casual curiosity than an existential search. Okay, what are these Hare Krishnas? What is this Bhagavad Gita? What is this philosophy? It's just like I may inquire about, if I hear about some new species of animal, if I hear about some new country, or I meet some person from a distant culture, I might be curious. So like that, I may be curious about bhakti also, about Krishna also. So that favorable curiosity, we could say, is relatively higher than the material, than being distressed or being knowledge seekers. But that may not lead to transcendence immediately. The curiosity satisfied, okay, I got to know about you, fine. I'm not interested in any spiritual business. or that curiosity may lead to it. So you could say all these three, the inquisitive, the distressed and the wealth seekers, are in one category where they are, you could say, circumstantial devotees. Their devotion is circumstantial. Where the jnanis, their search is motivated by existential questions. And so, from the existential to come to the transcendental is relatively easier. When I am from circumstantial services, begging me to come to Krishna, the circumstances change. Okay, I don't feel so much need for Krishna. But existential question means, what is the meaning of life? What happens after death? What ultimately counts? These questions are not dependent on circumstances. So existential devotion is much more easily elevatable to transcendental devotion. Okay. Thank you.
Second question is that you briefly mentioned about Christian faith. Now, what about the faith of Muslims? Second, and then they are called separatists or how they call?
Okay. So what about Muslims? What is the nature of their faith? See, even when I talk about Christians, there are Christians in the mode of goodness also, and there are Christians who could say very close to transcendence. There are they're interested purely in loving God. There are many, there's Saint Francis of Assisi and many others who just left everything for the sake of God. So we cannot equate any particular diverse category of people with one categorization. There will be Christians in goodness, in passion, ignorance. And same with Muslims. There will be Muslims in all the three modes. And in fact, there will be one in France, there's a female Muslim saint. She says, "Oh God, oh Allah, if I want to see you so that I can enjoy the pleasures of heaven, then please keep those pleasures far away from me. If I want to see you so that I can be saved from the fires of hell, then send me to those fires. But if I want to see you just so that I can love you, please do not hide yourself from me." It's a prayer of pure devotion. I have a Muslim friend who told me that it is easier for me to communicate with moderates of other traditions than extremists of my own tradition. So even in Islam, there are moderate Muslims who we could say are in goodness. And there are extremists who can be in passion or in ignorance. Now, among different religions, each religion, the majority of people in the world are in passion and ignorance. And similarly, in each religion also, majority of the people will be in passion and ignorance. Now, that religion's trajectory will be determined largely by what is the mode in which the leaders of that religion are. If the leaders are in goodness, then the passion and the ignorance, which is what most people will be in, that will be relatively moderated and controlled. But if the leaders are in passion or ignorance, then the people who are in passion and ignorance will just get misled widely. So generally in most religions, if you consider the Vedic path, there has been a separation of material and spiritual powers. You could say the spiritual power was invested in the Brahmanas. They used to give knowledge, they used to perform the rituals, and they used to give spiritual guidance. And the material power, the political power, was kept in the Kshatriyas. In Buddhism also, Buddha was the spiritual teacher. And the Buddhist monks, the lamas, never became martial rulers. It was Ashoka who spread Buddhism when he adopted it. Christianity also, Jesus was more of a Brahmanical person. He is the center of spiritual power. It is only when the Roman emperors, they took up Christianity that it spread. Now, in Islam, however, right from its beginning, the spiritual and the political have been mixed together. Because Muhammad was both the spiritual teacher and the political leader. Muhammad fought wars. So now, today's Islam's political leaders, they often quote Muhammad, especially while instigating their followers, they quote Muhammad's political example more than his spiritual example. In interfaith dialogues, Muslims will often talk about Muhammad's spiritual example, which is also there. At an individual level, for many Muslims, Islam is a way to a life of greater piety. It is a path to spiritual growth. But at a social or political level, because of the mixing of the political and the spiritual in the inception of Islam, at a social level, Islam often becomes more of a political search for power than a spiritual search for truth. Now, this has happened in all religions. It has happened in Christianity, it has happened in the Vedic path also, that religion becomes a political search for power rather than a religious search for truth. But Islam is more vulnerable to this than other religions because of the conflation of the political and the spiritual at its inception. So, in general, if there is to be harmony in the world, the mode of goodness and those who are in the mode of goodness need to be empowered. So, if moderates of the various religious traditions are empowered more and more, then there is possibility of greater harmony. Okay? Yes, please.
Thank you, Chaitanya Charan Prabhu. My question is, in terms of dealing with the astral body, with the pursuit of results, we like, you know, recalling, reading, you know, Srila Prabhupada saying, what is the use to be an American if you cannot do something great? And you know, so there is the desire for serving, you know, Krishna, Guru of Krishna, to actually do something, to achieve something. So that incentive is there and is very real as we come to Krishna consciousness. We strive for our soul, we strive to do something, you know, to offer something very nicely like that. Now, there's also things that we have to deal, at least I'm talking, just looking at myself and, you know, how I deal with this, that when results are not there, we tend to think, or at least I tend to think, that there's a deficiency in myself. So there's something that is missing that doesn't allow me to be empowered to achieve certain results. So we also see in Srila Prabhupada, you know, when we read something like, remember also, Krishna will be ready to give you the whole world in 18 days if you are Krishna conscious. You know, just parallel, Arjuna winning the world in 18 days. So, meaning that I can infer that it's a deficiency in myself because I'm not Krishna conscious, I don't have this result. Like that. So, how do you deal with that?
Okay.
That sort of sense of, you know,
yeah,
right.
I got it. So we all have a desire to do some, to make some offering to our spiritual master in a mood of service. And for that, if we don't get a facility, some facility, then we can we see that it is because of some deficiency in me that Krishna is not giving this facility? Answer, yes. It is always good to have the thoughts that bring humility within us. So if the not getting some facility or some result If that makes me angry with others, that makes me frustrated with the world, and that creates negativity out there. Oh, you know, you are so bad, you are not doing this, you are not doing this, you are not doing this. If that's what happens to us, then we can say that that's undesirable. That is not bringing humility. That is simply our frustrated controllership coming out. So if instead I think that it is something which is lacking in me, and I need to become more pure, I need to become more purposeful, purely purposeful, it is anukul to our bhakti, it is favorable to our devotion, and we can think like that. At the same time, we can't read the mind of Krishna. That is quite a speculative and sometimes a distracting thing to do, to think, you know, why is Krishna doing this? Sometimes it may not even be Krishna doing this, sometimes it may just be the circumstances like that. And some people say, in some countries, the government is opposed. So, and the government doesn't allow us to practice bhakti publicly, or even privately there is threat. Now, is it that Krishna is doing that? No, it is people who have misusing their free will, misusing their power, who are doing that. Krishna is sanctioning that. Now, Krishna can bring good even out of that. But how Krishna will bring out that good, that we may not know. So, we could say that maybe there's something which I need to improve so that I can become more devoted, so that Krishna will give the results eventually. But we also know that there are some devotees who are bhajanandis. Gaur Krishna Das Babaji never had very few disciples practically. And Bhakti Sanat Thakur had many more disciples. Srila Prabhupada had even more disciples. Now, does that mean that, you know, the subsequent acharya is greater than the previous acharya? One devotee asked Srila Prabhupada, Prabhupada, Bhakti Sanat Thakur preached in Bengal and Orissa. Bhakti Sanat Thakur preached all over India. You preached all over the world. Therefore, it means you are greater than all of them. And Prabhupada said, never think like this. It is by their mercy that I have done whatever I have done. The parents are happy when their children become greater than them. So, for us, we should, if that thinking that there is some deficiency in me, and let me try to work on the deficiency, if that helps us intensify our devotion, that is favorable. But if that makes us unnecessarily feel guilty and impure, guilty and insecure and unworthy and disheartened in the practice of our bhakti, then that is unfavorable. So if I have some conditioning I am battling with, and it's going to take me a long time to get over it, I am fighting with it for years and it's not going away, then if I think, you know, because I have this conditioning and that's why I am not getting the results for this service, and oh, this conditioning is not going to go away for many, many years, that means for many years I won't get any result. So what is the use of practicing bhakti? No, that kind of thinking is unfavorable for our bhakti. So we should say that, okay, whatever situation I am in, Krishna, I want to connect with you, and when you want, you give me the results. And if there is something which you want me to change, please guide me how to do it, what to do and how to do it. So basically, we can try to analyze why something is happening. That's using our intelligence in Krishna's service. But we shouldn't let any kind of analysis make us disheartened in Krishna bhakti. If our analysis is making us disheartened, if I start thinking, oh, people today are so materialistic that they are not going to become devotees only. This is Kali Yuga and this is such a materialistic world, so people are not going to become devotees, and therefore what is the use of preaching? If people are anyway not going to become devotees, what is the use of preaching? Now that analysis is making me disheartened in bhakti. Therefore, I have to turn away from that analysis, or I have to reanalyze the situation. Yes, but still, there are some people who are becoming spiritual. Vegetarianism has come up now, yoga has come up, environmental consciousness has come up. So, holistic medicine has come up, mindfulness has come up. So, these five things basically are broadly indicative of an increase in sattva in today's world also. all the mode of passion, ignorance are increasing, but this is also increasing. So therefore, maybe let me target people in this category by which I can move towards Krishna. So sometimes the results may not be coming. It could be because of some deficiency in us, but it could also be because of some external circumstance not being right. So my point is that we also have to work at the material level to make sure that we are working effectively. Prabhupada could have thought that, oh, Indians are not becoming devotees because there is some deficiency in my devotion. But he did not think that way. He thought that, okay, whatever my devotion is, he, in fact, in his Markine Bhagavad Dharma, he signs it as the most unfortunate. He says, Bhakti nahi, Veda nahi, Nama Khubidaro. He says, I have neither devotion nor knowledge, but I just have faith in the Holy Name. That's his humility at one level. But my point is that Prabhupada was not satisfied simply with the internal analysis. He did an external analysis also. And he saw that Indians are enamored by the Westerners. So if Western people become devotees, then Indians will follow them. Therefore, let me go to the West. So basically, when our service is not producing results, we need to do internal analysis and try to improve our devotion. And we also need to do external analysis and evaluate whether there is something that needs to be changed in the external way in which we are doing our service, by which the results will come. Okay? Thank you. Yes, Prabhu.
Thank you for blessing us with your wonderful teachings and classes in your presence. I can relate to it a lot, like some rights. And so one appreciation question I have is that your particular talk reminded me of Hanuman and the spider, where Hanuman had the prosperity of strength, and Hanuman had the spider had the poverty of weakness. And in that passing, Lord Ramachandra essentially told Hanuman, my dear Hanuman, I'm more pleased with the spider because although you have the credentials, the spider has the essentials. Sarvapati Birdam Mutam Tapra Dwayne Nimra. Hanuman had the upadi, the false upadi that he had some strength, and the spider didn't. Mm-hmm. So, one thing I appreciate about the one thing that Radha Maharaj mentioned is that regarding poverty, rich, those who are rich and those who are poverty. And so he was quoting Prabhupada when he was giving a sannyas initiation to Mother Bhakti Prabhu. So he said, once a devotee asked Srila Prabhupada was asked by the devotee for permission to renounce everything. And Prabhupada's response was, Krishna owns everything, so what do you have to renounce? The only thing you have to renounce is the misconception that you have something to renounce. And so my question is kind of related to the Bali Maharaj pastime, where he thought he had something to give. And so the tendency is that when the spiritual master is there, we're humble. I have no possessions, I have no abilities. But when the spiritual master or somebody disguises themselves, Bhamanade disguises himself, so the tendency is that when we're with other devotees, the tendency is hard to maintain your humility that I have no possessions, I have no abilities. But you were mentioning the other day that we should always keep our mind that the boss is always watching. Krishna Yadi Kripa Kade Kone Bhagavani Guru Vatsayami Rupe Shikoya Pani. The Lord is always disguised within everyone's heart. So how to maintain, to keep that in mind, because the tendency is, like I said, when we associate with other Lords, we forget, I have more power than you. Then when the spiritual master comes, I'm so humble, I don't have any powers. So how to maintain that integrity?
So sometimes we may have the material ability, say like Hanuman had, but then the squirrel had the essence of devotion. Lord Ram appreciated that. So sometimes we may, in front of our spiritual master, act as very humble, say I have no abilities, but then with others we may put on a show, I have so much power, or we may dominate others based on our abilities or power. So how do we maintain that integrity? Actually, it's not necessary that it's lacking in integrity if our behavior with different devotees is different. In fact, Bhakti Rasa Upadeshamrita also says that if a devotee is chanting the holy names, you respect them in the mind. A devotee is initiated, offer them obeisances. A devotee who is dedicated to serving Krishna, offer them initiation. A devotee is pure-hearted, completely absorbed in Krishna, offer your life to them. So definitely there is an etiquette in which there is a different way of dealing with different people. But overall, there is respectfulness towards everyone. Now, humility is something which a devotee needs to have with everyone. But the humility may be expressed in different ways in different situations. Sometimes humility may be expressed by bowing down to a person, by hearing some submissively from them. And sometimes humility may also be expressed by, in a humble mood of service, giving some instructions to others. The Prabhupada defines humility in a very pragmatic way in the 13th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, 8 to 12. That humility means to not be anxious, to have the satisfaction of being honored by others. So if I have my subordinates, sometimes I may just speak pleasing words to them so that they will stay subordinate to me. So that they will think, they will stay my followers. And sometimes to speak strongly actually requires humility. Why? Because when I speak strongly to someone, I risk losing that person. That person may go away from me. And if I am proud, if I have arrogance, then I may get my security by how much followers I have. And so it could be that pride makes me pamper my followers and humility empowers me to speak strongly. Now, the converse is also possible. That, you know, I think I am so humble, who am I to instruct? And I don't instruct when an instruction is needed also. And I'm so proud that I think, what do you know? You know, you just listen to me. So we don't know exactly what is motivating whom in what situation. So for us, we can be introspective and we can evaluate our consciousness when I'm dealing with others. What is my mood? Sometimes if Krishna has given us more abilities than others, then we may have to take a position appropriate for doing justice to those abilities. The same example of Hanuman and the squirrel. Normally the focus is on that now Hanuman is also a great devotee. And it is not that he lacks the substance of devotion. And this pastime I have not seen in the Valmiki Ramayana. It is in other renditions of the Ramayana. So usually when I tell that pastime, I said some of the monkeys said. Because I don't want to cast Hanuman in a negative light. Just the point here is that Hanuman or the monkeys, when they felt that the squirrel is coming in the way, now Ram told them that she is serving according to her capacity, you are serving according to yours, and I am pleased with both. So he wanted to focus on the substance of devotion. But at the same time, if Ram had the squirrel build the bridge for him, how long would it have taken? These huge monkeys, they with huge bodies brought huge boulders. So when Srila Prabhupada was departing from the world at that time, he told what will enable the spread of the Krishna consciousness movement all over the world? He said, it is organization and intelligence. He did not say at that time purity, he did not say how attentively you chant the holy names. Now that is also important. But for the result to manifest in this world, certain material skills are also required. Brahmanas will be simply satisfied with their knowledge. If somebody comes to seek knowledge, they will give knowledge. But it is Kshatriyas who will want to create a change in the world. And they will create systems by which change can be made. So Prabhupada said we need Brahmanas with a Kshatriya spirit. So the point which I am making is, we need to also look at the material abilities and say if somebody has got good managerial ability and then they tell, you know, you do this, you do this, you do this, and somebody else doesn't have the managerial ability, if they try to delegate, they make a mess of things. So functionally, I may be in a position of authority and I may instruct others, but I see that simply as a service to Krishna. So I don't dominate others, I don't disrespect others, but in the mood of service, we engage others. However, it, as you said, we may be respectful to our seniors, our spiritual master, so that we can dominate our juniors. So in that case, humility becomes the price for entering into a power structure where we offer respect so that we can get respect. that is very insidious. Then I am completely two-faced. That in front of my seniors, oh, you have power, so I'll offer respect to you. But now, in front of my juniors, I have power, you must respect me. So our mood, however, is that in both, while dealing with our juniors and our seniors, we have a mood of service. The way we serve is different. And as devotees, our disposition is one. That I am a servant of Krishna. But our position and our action may vary depending on with whom we are interacting. So that we use our intelligence in Krishna's service. Okay? So, we'll stop. Do we have time? Okay. One last question. Yes, bro.
Thanks for the talk. That was brilliant. I was hearing that you mentioned the relationship with happiness, the relationship or the lack thereof, happiness and thinking. And I remember that one of the techniques of torture was tickling people until they literally imploded.
Tickling?
Yeah, tickling for hours until they imploded.
Oh God.
They had internal bleeding until they died. When they didn't have the information they were looking for or something, they were tortured, tickling people. This is
Oh, okay. So, thank you very much. Grantraj Srimad Bhagavatam ki, Srila Prabhupada ki, Gaura Bhakta Vrinda ki, Nidai Gaur Premanande.
Srila
Prabhupada ki. Thank you.